Welcome to the Intellectual Talk Show. I'm David.
I'm Whitney.
And today we're sitting down with Shotgun Tom Kelly, San Diego's iconic radio and television legend, a guy I grew up with on KUSI Kids Club and K-Earth. And, just everywhere you turn, there was Shotgun Tom. But you didn't have that experience.
No, I didn't have that experience because I didn't grow up in San Diego. But I did get to hear his voice on 1,000 Ways to Die.
Ooh, terribly cool show. We're going to talk to him about 1,000 Ways to Die, his radio legend status, and more. Join us. And now we're sitting down with Shotgun Tom Kelly. One of my childhood icons, a fan favorite of everybody I know in San Diego. And he joined us on the podcast late last year, and now you're here with us on our talk show for television and YouTube. Like, this is amazing. Thank you for sitting down with us.
Yeah, oh, man, great to be here, Dave. Great to be here indeed.
So, since the podcast, few things have changed for you.
Yeah.
A little bit of a career shift.
Yes.
Can you fill us in a little bit on what's been going on?
Well, I work for CBS Radio, or I worked for CBS Radio, and so they decided to end the ambassadorship program that I was on, where I did all the personal appearances for the station, did a couple of weekend shows, did promos and stuff like that. So I guess they wanted to go a different way. So they decided to end my 3-year deal, but they got to pay me the 2 years left on my contract. So I guess I'm still getting paid. I'm just not doing the work, Dave.
Well, that's like the American dream, right?
I guess it is. But I like to, I like to do the work.
No, you're a busy man.
I've got some other things.
You've never been afraid of working. I know that.
No.
I know that much from when I was a kid. You're everywhere. So.
Well, you got to, in media, you have to do a few things,
Yeah.
The only thing I don't write, I don't do columns. Most people write a column. I don't do that. Mm. But TV, radio, I do that. And I've done that for, hate to say this, 50 years I've been in this business.
It's a long time.
Congratulations.
I know.
That's great.
I always want to kind of maybe lie about that, Oh, I've only been in about 30 years, But no, I started in 1966 at KPRI here in San Diego, my hometown.
Yeah. And it's, what, whose brilliant idea is it to let somebody like Shotgun Tom go? Like,
well, just,
I don't get the business decision.
Well, a year ago, Dave, I was making a lot of money.
No.
Yeah. And a year ago, they decided.
I knew what that was like.
A year ago, they decided, we got to cut back the payroll here. So my contract came up for renewal. And they said, well, we don't want to fire Shotgun, so we'll just create a new gig. So the new gig was the ambassadorship. Mm-hmm. So they took me off the air. I took a huge pay cut, and they paid me this other, it was very nice, but not as much as I was making.
Right.
But anyway, all I had to do was 2 weekend shows, which I tracked. That took about, 20 minutes a week. And then I did, on Monday, I did all the announcements for the station. That took about, 6 minutes for the whole week. Yeah. So basically I wasn't there. And then I did personal appearances. Now those are like 2 hours at a time, like I'm appearing at Vaughn's or I'm appearing at Ralph's or appearing at some phone place.
That's the sort of stuff that you love anyway.
I love
interacting with people.
And you know why? Because when I appear at those places, one of my favorite things to do is tell the fans that I'm going to be there. And I get to meet them, and it's just a wonderful opportunity because I love my fans. Yeah. I mean, well, without people who care about me on the radio and have listened to me or watched me on television, and they feel they know me. So, and I know how that feels because I used to be a fan.
Yeah, that was one of the great things on the podcast talking to you was you talking about the people you were a fan of and finally getting to meet them and work with them and move your career forward alongside them.
Yeah.
And that's, of course, how I'm feeling sitting opposite the table from you right now. Like, it's still a surreal thing for me that, you know my name, let alone sit
Dave,
down
are you
on
kidding
camera
me?
With me.
On the, let me tell you something. I've done a lot of these interviews, TV and radio, in L.A., San Diego. KUSI, of course, had me on because I worked there in the old. I worked there for 12 years in the old days. But KFMB, all that stuff. But I got to tell you something. Your podcast, and there was a friend of mine up in Long Beach who knows my shtick and he knows my stories. He's a very dear friend. And he says, you know, I tuned in on the Dave Dawson podcast and I heard some stuff from you that I didn't know about. And that was, it was actually a wonderful representation of my career. You brought stuff out of me that I don't usually tell on these other TV shows. However, I think one of the reasons in that garage, that's where we did it, my garage, we had time. Yeah. Usually on when I'm on KUSI or on Channel 7 in LA, or I just have a short period of time. So I gotta condense my stuff. But you made me feel relaxed. We were out there in the garage where my pool table is. We have these little parties every so often with my friends. And
I was fortunate enough to get to
parties. You can get to come great. Sometime, man. Yeah. Play pool. But anyway, it was very relaxing that day, as you know. Yeah. And so maybe that's why I opened up more with news stories.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's the thing that I like about the podcast is that we have that time to sit down and kind of let stories breathe, let the chat, the discussion breathe. I don't like doing interviews. But, you know, it's a wonderful compliment to hear that we got stuff out of you that people haven't heard
you
before.
You did, yeah.
Like that's,
yeah,
you
did.
Hopefully we'll get
good.
To hear some more stories on this show. So.
Yeah, a few more. But before we get to more stories, we have to break for commercial. So we'll be right back on the IntelleXual Talk Show.
Back with Shotgun Tom Kelly on the IntelleXual Talk Show. Now, Tom, I would like to know, you are born and bred here in Southern California,
yes.
And you made your way back. What was the journey to come back? Where did you go in
to
your
come
career?
Back to San Diego?
Yeah.
Or how I got to L.A. or something?
Whole nine yards.
Well, Wendy, I'll tell you. to come back to San Diego. Well, I got my feet in both areas. I still have an apartment in Hollywood, and then I come back every weekend to my home in Fletcher Hills, and we're working on a television pilot up there called Shotgun Tom Kelly's Neighborhoods, which, by the way, you can see it on YouTube.
I watched
it. And on Facebook, yeah. Mm-hmm. And we're using modern technology. We hired a drone company And so we're trying to sell that to a television station in Los Angeles. And we've got a couple of bites, and all we need to do is find a sponsor. Because doing a show like that is really expensive. I've got a great director, producer, Johnny Kay, who used to be my boss at K-Earth. He owns Los Feliz Post, and he's worked with Dick Clark, and he really knows what he's doing. So I really, really value his input. So that's the show that I'm working on right now. So basically, to answer your question, I got a foot in Hollywood and a foot in San Diego. My home, really, as you brought up, was in San Diego. I was born and bred here. And in fact, to be more explicit, I grew up in between Casa de Oro and Lemon Grove and La Mesa, which is a place called Fairway Drive. They had when I was a kid, they had a ditch down the middle of the street. They covered up the ditch. But I used to have a little radio station in my bedroom down there. And I used to go to a market called Valley Farms Market.
Which I live right across
from. Is that right?
Yep.
Oh, you know the place.
Uh-huh.
Well, they used to sell records there. Now, the record store in Lemon Grove, Keith's Record Den, they sold like a Beach Boy 45. Do anybody remember 45s with a big hole in it? Anyway, back in 63 or 4, I bought my 45s from Keith's Record Den, which was the place that you bought the big hits. But as a kid mowing lawns and trying to earn, you know, a couple bucks, I think I'd get a dollar a lawn back in those days. I needed to buy my records from a cheaper place. And Valley Farms Market, which is, as I said, in Casa de Oro there, near Bancroft Street, mm-hmm. they had these records, hits, for like 25 cents. So I couldn't pass it up. Of course, my mom and dad used to buy their meat from there and stuff like that. So that's a childhood memory that, you know, when I was, 12, 13, something like that.
Nice. Yeah, it's a good place. I mean, it's great that it's still around after all these years. I wish they still sold records, though. That'd
be
great.
That's too bad. They don't. I haven't been in there in years.
But nobody sells records.
Some people sell records. I have a record player.
Yeah, oh, that's right. You know what vinyl is?
I just got back.
I just got back from the Consumer Electronics Show, and there was several booths that offered turntables. And then some of your finer stereo stuff that costs thousands of dollars, those are purist audio guys, and they love
the
vinyl.
Files.
Yeah, they really do. Yeah. It's a vinyl is much more warm than a CD. But, you know, a lot of things are downloaded now.
Yeah.
You know, so everybody goes, you know, downloads this cut and that cut.
Yeah, I don't even remember the last time I bought a CD.
Yeah, see, Dave?
Yeah.
You know,
but I'm not a purist. Like I grew up on vinyl.
Neil
Diamond, you know, put the needle down, sing all the best.
We all did, man.
But you know, I don't know. I'm a child of the digital age. I got all my music on my phone. And I'm streaming it now. Even I'm not even buying it. I've got a subscription service and I'm just listening to it. But you've been an icon of an industry that has just continually been evolving and changing in the time that you've been a part of it.
Yeah.
What's it been like being on your side of the aisle on that? Because, I mean, you've been dealing with the musicians who are having to deal with the ever-changing face of how their media is consumed. You've been dealing with the studio people and the radio stations who are struggling to keep up with the internet. I mean, how has that transition been from your side of it?
Well, I in my business, you have to change. You know, you have to go with what's going on. Back when I started at KPRI, we played vinyl. Mm-hmm. You know, this was an FM station. This is before AM was the big stations. FM was kind of an experimental thing, or a background music thing. And at KPRI, we played albums. Later on, KPRI became a AOR station, an album-oriented station, and they played albums. And then of course, I went to Ogden's Radio Operational Engineering School to get my first-class FCC license. Now, if you had that license, which had nothing to do with announcing, had everything to do with rules and regulations of the FCC, math and electronics, stuff that I didn't want to hear about. But I had to get this. Once you got that license, you got a job at a big AM station. And that's how I went out and got my first job. Had to go pay my dues. Back in those days, you had to pay your dues. I got a job at KYOS in Merced. And then from there, I moved on to a little bigger station, KACY in Ventura. And then from there, I wanted to be a boss jock, you know. KHJ was the big boss radio station in Los Angeles. And I wanted to come home to San Diego. And the big boss station here in San Diego was KGB. So I sent a tape into KGB and when I was in Bakersfield, and we used the same jingles. So Charlie Van Dyke was the program director. He hired me at KGB, and that's when I came back to San Diego as a professional. And those days, we used records. Here, we're still using records. Then I went across the street to KCBQ, and then they changed to tape. We used tape. All the records were transferred to tape. And then from that point, we went to CDs.
Yeah, tape didn't last very long.
Yes.
Tape it lasted a good 6 years. Yeah. And then the CDs came out, and everybody was playing CDs. I mean, those were fascinating. Imagine a disc disappearing into your dashboard. You know, I also did that. I was the PR guy for Alpine Electronics Car Audio Nationals, which went on a 13-city tour. On who had the best car stereo system, and all the proceeds that Alpine produced went to Jerry Lewis and the Muscular Dystrophy Association, with which I was associated with for like 45 years.
Wow. Oh, I definitely want to talk to you about Jerry Lewis, but we got a break for commercials, so we'll be right back with Shotgun Tom on the Intellectual Talk Show.
Great. Hey, it's going good. It's going good.
before the commercial break, Shotgun was mentioning that he worked with Jerry Lewis. Mm-hmm. You have a picture, I believe,
I do.
With Jerry.
I do, indeed.
Tell us a little bit about what it was like working with him on... It was on the telephone.
Yes, for many years, yeah. And this picture here that I'm showing you right now was taken in the 70s, and I was the... I did
beard.
This.
I know.
Yeah. That's an epic beard.
Well, this is what I know. That was a little
Who would have thought those beards would be back in
time? I know! Isn't that amazing? Anyway, this was on... I was the carnival chairman. Jerry loved clowns. Now, clowns now are evil.
I went to clown school.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Well, anyway... I was
evil, right?
Yeah. Well, and one of my first television kid show was in Bakersfield on KERO TV, and I was Nemo the clown.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So anyway, some of the I got some jokes, but no, this was no joking. It was a good. This was when I was doing Words-a-Poppin, which is the television show I won the 2 Emmy Awards for over at Channel 10, and they came to town and they said the Muscular Dystrophy Association. We'd like you to be our backyard carnival chairman for the Muscular Dystrophy Association. And what we're going to do is send you to Las Vegas, going to get your picture taken with Jerry Lewis. And this picture that I'm holding right now was in every 7-Eleven store in San Diego and North County.
Wow. You know,
so, but anyway, we encourage the kids to send in for their kits. And then I would, as many as I could, I would go to the backyard carnivals, you know. And then we'd talk about it on
That's
the
awesome. Telephone. Now, before you take that picture away,
okay,
does it actually say, is it etched into the leather, Shotgun Tom?
Yes.
On the brim of the hat?
Yeah. That's when I had a leather guy down in Old Town wanted to make me a leather band for my hat, so he put Shotgun Tom on it.
That's cool. Actually, we put out on Facebook today that you were going to be on the show.
Okay.
And one of our local actors, Merrick MacArthur, one of our top actors in San Diego, wanted me to ask you very specifically, what's the deal with the hat?
Well, my parents used to go camping every year. Every summer, we used to go to Sequoia or Yosemite or one of the wonderful national parks here in California. And I really enjoyed the forest rangers. They were my friends, and I was a very inquisitive kid. And of course, I love Smokey the Bear.
Who didn't?
You know. So that was a childhood thing. And then when I worked at KCBQ in 1970, we were all hippies and we were trying to be different. And so I went ahead and came up with because I liked the hat, the block. And I came up with that hat, you know. So anyway, if you'll excuse me.
So the beard has come back, and with Farrell, the hat has come back
too. Yeah.
Farrell, yeah, yeah. Yeah, I got to take a... that's good booze.
If only.
Jackie Gleason, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, I just like to goof around.
You just wanted to do a
shtick. I'm just a child, Dave. Go ahead.
Now I lost my train of thought. Oh no.
Hats, beards.
Hats, yeah. Beards. It's all coming
hipster
back.
Hipster prototype.
Booze.
Oh, Shotgun Tom Kelly, hipster prototype.
Yeah. Everybody's stealing your look, man.
I know. By the way, you talked to Farrell. I was there when he got his star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame.
And you got a star on the Hollywood
Walk
of Fame,
I did,
too.
But I actually called him out. I said, Farrell, I've been using that hat for a long time. Yes, I did get a star. You want to see?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, let's hear
so
about
here
that.
So here's what is represented when they unveil the star. You have the Chamber of Commerce. You've got the president of the Chamber of Commerce, Leron Gubler. And you've got David Green, who's the chairman of the Star Committee. And there's the recipient of the star, me. Then Stevie Wonder was my speaker. And Johnny Kay, who's my producer of my television show, he was also one of the speakers. And Leron Gubler says, and now we welcome Shotgun Tom Kelly to the Hollywood Walk of Fame, they unveil it, and then they give you a plaque. Every star who gets a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, if I may, gets this one of these plaques. And they're
so
kind
cool.
Of, you know, you when you see somebody getting a star, whether it be a movie, person, some a recording artist, or you know, a celebrity who got a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. Most recently, Viola Davis got a star, and she's in Fences with Denzel Washington, and so she got one of these. So, anyway, this is the famous plaque that they all get. Now I have one, and I'm
so
proud.
It's a heavy duty plaque too.
It's beautiful.
This is not light duty.
Well, and you know what it depicts? It's actually how the star looks on Hollywood Boulevard.
Yeah, the marbling.
Yeah, they call this, there's a name for it. It's a certain type of cement, you know. But I'm very proud of that, you know.
Oh, you should be.
Because when you see big stars getting the same plaque you do, it's kind of groovy, you know. So.
Well, you're a big star yourself. Now, there's one thing about this. Hold this one up.
Sure, real quick. Sure.
So all these people are really impressive. But who's this guy looking in the back?
Oh, that's
looks like he's ready to steal your star.
Yeah, that's Juan. He's the guy who takes up, because the star plaque is pretty heavy. So he takes he takes it up and takes it away. But
well, that would explain his wardrobe.
Yeah,
he's the only person not in a suit.
He's got to do the heavy moving.
Yeah, he's on the sidelines. And this guy right here is Stevie Wonder's bodyguard, you know. So he's pretty insulated when he goes places.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Yeah.
I mean, it's tough to say that anybody really has much more fame than Stevie Wonder.
Oh, God, I love Stevie. I've known Stevie for many years. And Stevie is like a big kid, too.
Is he?
I remember when I got my new eye. He's an Apple freak. He loves Apple products. And I thought I was the first guy on the block to get the new Apple 6 Plus. It was the bigger phone. Mm-hmm. So I say, hey, Stevie, man, look what I got. And he goes, let me see that. He always says, let me see that. So he goes, you got an iPhone 6 Plus, huh? I said, yeah. And he pulled out his. Yeah, he is on it, man. He is so. And he just recently was on the Kennedy Honors, a couple of weeks ago. And he also was on Jimmy Fallon, The Tonight Show, doing when Michelle Obama was on. Yeah.
Oh, nice. You know.
And at my star, he said, do you think we have a Stevie Wonder song? You probably see it on YouTube at Shotgun Tom Kelly Hollywood.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this morning's Walk of Fame ceremony. We are delighted today to honor one of our favorite local radio personalities who is celebrating 40 years on the airwaves. And today, Hollywood honors Shotgun Tom Kelly.
It is truly my honor to be here to celebrate you, Shotgun, your 40 years air personality and being on the radio. No, it's truly an honor. And the thing about it is, it's always wonderful to meet people who not only inspire you from afar, but to meet someone who has a great spirit and on and off stage, on the radio and off the radio. So truly it is my joy to have come today to say some good things about you, Tom Kelly.
Yeah!
What do we do? Do a Stevie Wonder song?
Yeah, I think we should.
One, two, la, 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 la. Shotgun Tom Kelly, we listen to you on the radio. Thank you. God bless you.
You better believe it, baby. He did the same thing for Michelle Obama on The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon. He goes, only he changed the words, and he said, my Michelle Amore, you know, so it was
great. We'll be back with more Shotgun Tom after this. Welcome back to the Intellectual Talk Show. We're sitting down with my childhood icon, Shotgun Tom Kelly. And you just told us a bunch of stuff about the Hollywood Walk of Fame experience.
Yeah.
But I had the pleasure when we did the podcast with you of getting to see your I Love Me room.
Yeah.
And there was one picture in particular when you brought me into that room that just drew my attention. And I think because it captures one of the reasons why I love you as a celebrity.
Thank you, Dave.
Is that you really seem to care about your fans.
I do.
Immensely.
I do.
And this picture.
Yeah, this one right here. This was taken by.
It just says everything about
it. It was taken by Hollywood producer Alan Brent Cannell, who's producing a show on TNT called Animal Kingdom about, you know, bad people.
About bad people in Oceanside.
Oh, yeah, Oceanside. You know the show.
Yeah, yeah.
He was there at my star. He took this. I got out of the limo, and instead of going over and talking to Stevie or some of the principals, I went right to the crowd. Because I vowed, if I ever had an opportunity to be in radio and television, I would make sure that I was kind to all the people who made me, who listened to me, and who have watched me on television. So this was an opportunity for me to do just that.
Yeah, that's such a great picture.
You're just so full of glee right there. It's great.
I was very happy. And I didn't know what was going to happen. I didn't want to get up to the microphone and go, hee ba da ha ba da ha ba da he ba da ha. That would have been terrible. So I hired a Hollywood scriptwriter to write my stuff for the star. You know, sound bites. You got to do sound bites, you know.
Yeah.
And like one of my sound bites is, I thought it'd be nice to get a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. My daughter, Melanie, and my son, Nicholas, they said, you know, Daddy, one day you're going to get a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. And I thought they were crazy. Oh, but God bless him. That conversation just occurred last week. That was written by Ken Levine. It was written for The Simpsons, MASH, Frasier. So he did my stuff.
Nice.
It's very presidential of you to have a speechwriter, and probably rubbed off, right? You got to meet a president.
Well, Wendy. Oh, I did. I didn't want to stub my toe. Now, yes, I did. In the 80s, Ronald Reagan would always come to San Diego. Because San Diego was his lucky city. And my congressman at the time, Duncan Hunter, and his son, by the way, is the congressman now. But Duncan said, how would you like to emcee the rally for the president? And I said, I'd love to. And so as you see Ronald Reagan there, and I'm standing to the side just after he was introduced. And so I got to do that. So after, this was at the San Diego Downtown Community Concourse when he came to town. And he said, why don't you give one of your hats to the president? And I said, wow, that would be kind of neat. And he said, I'll arrange it. So I got a call when I was doing the KUSI Kids Club over at KUSI TV. And your appointment with the president has been approved. Flew back to Washington, D.C., went into Duncan's office there on Cannon Row. That's where all the congressmen have their offices. Got into his car. Went over to the White House, and we're waiting in the West Wing, outside the Oval Office. And the White House staff guy comes out, and he says, Duncan, shotgun, the president is ready to see you. Mr. Reagan, we opened the door, the seamless door there in the Oval Office, saw Mr. Reagan behind the desk. He got up from the desk, walked over to the shell bookcase, and he knew my name. He says, well, Shotgun, I understand that you were the MC and kept the people entertained in San Diego when I was there. And I said, yes, Mr. President, I did. And I bring you one of my trademark Ranger hats, and I hope that you'll put it on. And there it is. That's the White House photo.
Ronald Reagan always just looks so happy.
He does.
Yeah. Well, he's a show business. I remember you're only supposed to have 5 minutes with the president, any president, because they're pretty busy. We started talking about broadcasting and show business, and I was in the Oval Office for 10 minutes. It was great. Talking about microphones, and he was talking about recreating the games, the ball games, because they couldn't afford, in his day, to send the announcers on the road with the team. And he says, well, you probably don't remember that. I said, well, Mr. President, I really do. When I was in San Diego growing up, Al Shuss and Al Coupe used to recreate the Padre games when the Padres were away. So, yes, I do know what that's all about.
That's amazing. And I know exactly what it feels like to have somebody you look up to and admire, like, know your name and be just amazed. Because I'm sitting with the man who knows my name, and I'm still amazed about it. We're here with Shotgun Tom, and we'll be back after the break.
We're back on the IntelleXual Talk Show with Shotgun Tom Kelly. Hi, Tom.
How you doing? And you know, I got to tell you something. I've been stubbing my toe through this interview, and I want to let all the folks know that Shotgun makes mistakes at times. I've been calling Whitney Wendy, and I apologize for that.
Perfectly all right, Tom.
Hey, listen, I'll tell you what. Let's make it that you can call me Pop Gun.
All right, Pop Gun.
Yeah. I don't know if anybody else caught it, but I giggled enormously the first time.
Boy, somebody should have said something, you know.
I did. I laughed.
Oh, you laughed, but Dave, you should have pointed it out.
Well,
Shotgun, what in the depths of your ignorance? What is it that you want, you know?
I'm from the Midwest, so I'm just politely, you can call me anything.
And I'm still just a little starstruck, so.
Wow.
So,
yes.
Shotgun, I have a question that I've been wanting to ask this entire time.
Ask me anything.
Well, you have a very storied career. You've done everything. What else do you want to do?
Well, not everything.
Well, okay, not everything.
Yeah,
is there something that you really want to do in your career that you haven't gotten to do yet? What is it?
Well, I still do voiceover, even though I'm not working for Kay. I did voiceover when I was working at Kay. I was in the Denzel Washington movie as a disc jockey. Deja Vu, did you ever see that movie? I was in there twice, at the beginning of the movie and at the end.
Mm-hmm.
And is there anything that I want to do? I want to do this TV show, Shotgun Tom Kelly's Neighborhoods. That is what I really want to do. I want to continue my voiceover work because I was the voice of America's Most Wanted for many years. You know, to date, you have been responsible for 951 captures. This is America's Most Wanted with host John Walsh. Now let's join the manhunt. Here's John Walsh. And another one that the young kids are very familiar with. Some of my friends who hear me do this television show on the Spike Network, they say, Shotgun, I love your stuff, but I can't get involved. I mean, this is a show where people do stupid things to kill themselves. And so...
So it's everyday life.
Yeah, they do some, you know, you don't mean to kill yourself, but...
I think that's Darwinism.
I don't know. But on A Thousand Ways to Die, let me just tell you one of the little memorable episodes. Meet Chester and Lester, two speed freaks just looking to get high. So they decided to rob a small-time magician who was looking for his killer act. They snorted some white powder, but what they didn't realize, it was G4. It gelled in their sinuses, and they suffocated to death. Now, that small-time magician finally found his killer act. He made two drug addict speed freaks disappear on A Thousand Ways to Die. Thank you.
Yeah, they're all fans of that show.
So that's the other Shotgun, and not just the shot. Hey, Shotgun Tom, you better believe it, baby, you know. By the way, that sound is what I did in San Diego for many, many years. And we brought Chicago, the group Chicago, to L.A. And one of the guys in the band, the bass player who took Peter Cetera's place, is from San Diego, went to Point Loma High. His name is Jason Sheff. And so we brought the Chicago group to, I think they were on with the Doobie Brothers. And so we got our pictures taken with, you know, Robert Lamb and the horn section. And this kid, he said, Shotgun, I got to go on, man, but I got to talk to you. So anyway, he went on, and so Robert Lamb came on. I was backstage. Hey, talk to Jason. He needs to talk to you. And so I said, okay. What happened is Jason Sheff, who's the bass player, replaced Peter Cetera. He said, oh, man, I'm so glad you're here. Hey. I gotta get back on and do an encore, but don't go away. I said, no, I'm staying right here. So he went and did his encore, and he was doing 25 or 6 to 4. 25 or 6 to 4. And I'm going, what in the hell's all that about? Turns out, when I was at KCBQ in the 70s, we were giving away the Chicago 5 LP. So I said, give me a call. Fifth caller receives the Chicago 5 LP. Would be a winner right now. 297-0043. So anyway, hey, who's this? My name is Jason. I said, Jason, you're a winner of the Chicago 5 LP. Congratulations to you. What do you do? What are your hobbies? Well, I play bass in a little rock and roll band. I said, Jason, maybe someday you'll be playing bass with Chicago. I just pulled it out of my head. And now he told that story to me. After he got off stage.
That's amazing.
He said, Shotgun, had it not been for you, I wouldn't have got to know the Chicago charts and play the Chicago music. You got me interested in the group, and I've been with the group for 25 years. Isn't that cool?
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
It is.
That's incredible.
Blows me away, baby.
Well, I bet.
I'm going to have another one.
I can only imagine how many people have been influenced by you over the years.
Well, I hope. Because,
you know, quite frankly, one of the things that I'm doing here is trying to do what I saw you doing when I was a kid, you know, multidisciplined, you know, TV, radio, whatever. Like, everywhere I turned, there you were. And that's sort of what we're trying to do here, too.
Well, you know, Tommy Sablon, who is Jeff and Jared's producer, he was my producer early on. And so he has become a very famous producer. He's, by the way, he is in the Chicago National Radio Hall of Fame as one of the outstanding producers. And he got famous through Jeff and Jer. So he always says, you know, had it not been for you, I wouldn't have this job. But he's real famous, Tommy Sablon. Yeah. You know? But just what you were saying, Dave, I'm really very pleased that maybe I've done something to maybe influence somebody to get into this biz, because this business can be very cruel, you know.
But it can also be magical.
It can be magical, yes. And, you know, you have to put up with a lot. You have to make no money when you first start out. I made $1.25 an hour at KPRI in 1966, and you don't start out making the big bucks.
Yeah. I look forward to the day that I'm Shotgun Tom and making the big bucks. Until then, help us get to where we're making the big bucks and watch these commercials. We'll be back on the Intellectual Talk Show. We're back with the Intellectual Talk Show, and it's been just an honor to sit with Shotgun Tom Kelly for a second hour now. Like,
I love that.
I'm incredibly blessed, and in the jealous nature of my friends is going to kick in soon. I am in awe of your career, sir. I am in awe of your generosity and your kindness to me and to everybody that I've seen you interact with. And I don't think there's a better person to be a representation of San Diego than you in,
oh, how nice, Steve.
In the public eye.
And, thank you, baby.
And with everything that's happened in our city in the last week or so,
we
need wonderful people.
Oh, man. I used to do the Chargers Jumbotron, and I probably have lost that job.
lost that job. But, I mean, at this point, who would want it, right?
Ah, well. Anyway.
Them and their ugly logo.
Did you hear they got booed the other night at the Staples game?
Yeah, it's amazing.
You know?
It's amazing.
Loyalty means a lot to sports fans.
Yeah.
Just saying.
But anyway.
Yeah, he didn't even have the decency to do his press conference here saying goodbye.
I don't know. I'm just the announcer on the Jumbotron. and I was hoping they'd stay here.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Well, I'm not a big football fan myself, but, you know, I have plenty of friends who are, and it's just, it's hard to see people who are passionate about something be so let down like that. But, you know, life goes on. We keep moving forward.
Yeah.
You know?
Door closes, window opens. Maybe we'll get a soccer team.
That's my hope.
Soccer? That could be.
Yeah. That's what they did in St. Louis when the Rams left. MLS.
Somebody was saying there's going to be a professional Frisbee team coming into town. Anyway, I have some parting gifts for you, if I could have them right here.
Oh.
This is an official Shotgun Tom Kelly bobblehead.
That's a lot of teeth.
Yes, it is. Now listen, I want when this thing comes, it's got my story on the back.
And the Ronald Reagan picture.
And of course, the words popping on the side. Yep. But I, when you take this out, please be careful of my neck, because when you bobble my neck too much, I feel it.
Okay. It's a voodoo bobble.
It's a voodoo voodoo. It's a voodoo voodoo. Okay, and then I get you an official Shotgun Tom Kelly Hollywood Walk of Fame hat. This is a lot of my fans wore these. They won them on the radio station, and it is. You've got yourself an official Shotgun Tom Walk of Fame pin to go along with that. Those are yours. So enjoy.
Beautiful bubble.
I mean, this might. I got a huge head, but
there he is.
Looks good.
It's got the strings.
Shotgun Dave Dawson, everybody. And Whitney.
And me.
You better believe it, baby.
And you actually told us the You Better Believe a Baby story on the podcast, which
I did.
Really,
yes.
Cool.
Yeah. You know, I'm not trying to be kind to you. More people have heard me on that Dave Dawson podcast, and they've heard all the stories, you know, that I don't usually get to tell on shows. So I thank you for making that happen.
I thank you, sir.
All right, baby.
It's a pleasure having
you
on the show.
Thanks for joining us.
And Whitney, nice to see you too, babe.
And, you know, thank you all for joining us on the Intellectual Talk Show. It's been just a joy having Shotgun Tom on this episode. And make sure you tune in again next week for our next episode. Till then, take care.
Good night, everybody! Way to go, baby!
't to miss the next episode of the Intellectual Talk Show, where we interview Mr. Nathan Darrow, a.k.a. Mr. Freeze, a.k.a. Meacham, a.k.a. Andrew Madoff, a.k.a. The dude has a really long IMDb, okay? Just watch the show.